the impeachment of Blagojevich. I mean, I think we can all agree that that was all heartache, really. I mean, they really got America to rally up together and get rid of these corrupt politicians.
Really
and
stuck it to them. They were the leaders of the revolution.
Shit out of my face.
So what are we? We are we're power pop. We are punk alternative. We are
emo. We're emo.
Definitely emo.
I'd say we're a bit of 80s love song.
I would definitely say so. I've heard death metal.
Death metal. I don't know who came up with that one. That's not us.
That doesn't sound like us at all.
Most of the earlier works were much more hard.
Oh,
hard
it's,
rock.
It's
driven.
It's really
music.
Gritty, and there's a hint of relatability to that. You hear Fried and you just think like I'm a teenager. I'm upset. I have problems, and that really just related in it.
With many of their first albums, I mean. A lot of them were much more low budget, and I think people, as a people, kind of related better to it because they looked at Heartache at those times and they're like they're normal people. They can't afford the huge budget studios, but they're still getting these great songs out.
You know, kind of like when you're watching the news and you see a guy who just strangled his wife to death. People relate to that, and it's. It's kind of that grainy quality that really, I think, gets to me, personally, as a person.
A Heartache Remembered epitomizes, for me, it sums up the heartache that all people feel and the emotions that all of us as human beings go through.
And this is Mitch's house right here. This is right here on the left. And this is where we pretty much grew up our musical careers and everything of that sort. We did all our first recordings here. We wrote a lot of music here. We've had parties here. We've had groupies. Pretty much the whole musical spectrum. The life of a band has been at this house here. In the basement is also Newman Studios. Our record label and police officer just gave me the finger. Okay, he's gone.
Well, the earliest memory I have is sitting in the Leeds basement, and he handed me a piece of paper with the lyrics to the first song that Heartache ever did, which I believe was Cry on My Shoulder, and I kind of laughed at it and said, is this a joke? Is this like your creative writing class? Like, are you on acid? But I really didn't think it was going to take off and become the sensation that it really is.
Origami Guitar, I think, began that was really their psychedelic progressive rock album. And I have to say that moving to deeper levels, I mean... they sold out on that.
Yes.
Could that be any more commercial?
Who wants to listen to the 17-minute moving to deeper levels?
They did that for the money. They really did.
It was
just like quick, easy, get it done with and produce it for the money. That's really all they did it, for.
There was no meaning behind the song. It was very much just incoherent guitar work.
Mindless
drumming.
I really think they could have touched on some deeper issues.
Well, Heartache played a few times in my basement, you know, well, we could get togethers. Every time, the energy just quadrupled each time. New, like, layers were found in the music that we discovered. And it would just flow out of the speakers, and you'd just be, like, absorbing the rays of awesomeness that you just can't get anywhere else but there. It's like they were channeling Led Zeppelin, The Who, and The Stones, and all doing this with a more modern feel for a more modern world.
It's one of those shows where you're not fist pumping, you're not dancing. It's really just you sit there and just take in the groove, and it's like nothing I've ever seen. I mean, it's uncomparable to any other band. It's truly in a league of its own.
I got all the vocals tonight, but that's not how it always goes. You know, I mean, Mike.
He was just best suited for this for a little help from my friends. He can really belt it out. Yeah.
I don't want to toot my own horn, but I
can. Well, I mean, you can. You're good.
I'm not playing horn.
That
was just a colloquial.
I'm gonna set my drums on fire. Or I want to.
Have you called the pyro guy yet?
No, I haven't. Oh crap! All right, I gotta do that.
We haven't called the pyro guy.
Has anyone even set that up yet?
No.
The Jets.
I thought you were.
I forgot to do that.
You? Oh, Josh, you were supposed to do it.
Yeah.
I thought Kyle was supposed to do it.
It's cool.
I'll just talk to the blaming.
Shut up. Okay. We're doing an interview,
okay,
right?
Okay. No high tension.
I'll talk to the drum guy, and I'll ask if I can set it on fire. I'm sure it will not be a problem.
Okay.
What if it is?
It's not gonna... I don't even want to think about it. It's not gonna be a problem.
All right. We'll just do it anyways.
Are we gonna have a kit after you light it on fire?
I guess I'll light it. Light half of it.
What are you gonna do with the other half?
I don't.
What are we gonna play? What are you gonna play on once?
Okay, guys, look, you're way overthinking this. I'm gonna play it as it's burning. It'll give that sound.
What if your sticks burn?
Isn't that dangerous?
I don't know. Okay, I'm not a pyrotechnic guy. Somebody was supposed to call him.
I thought Kyle was supposed to call him. I'm not blaming you. I just thought you did.
I asked him. Had he called him yet?
Okay.
I think that would be an obvious. Well, assertion that I wasn't supposed to call
I
him.
I am sorry. I was busy talking to the sound people. I apologize. Yeah. Mike, what were you doing?
I was asleep. I was knocked out for the party last night.
Fair enough. Does anybody know where we're going next?
No, I have no idea.
Like, is it Seattle? Well, or?
All I know, I'm going to have to call ahead and get drums and call...
Oh, my Lord.
Oh my God. This is going to be a headache.
Let's try a street show, where just on the street...
Okay.
Well, like...
So we don't have to book anything.
Good idea.
We're going to Milwaukee.
Is that where
it is?
It.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's it. Right.
Show in Milwaukee? That's kind of cool.
Milwaukee,
I thought we had,
and
like,
then
a venue in
do we?
Fargo, Minnesota.
No, we don't have a venue.
Fargo?
Yeah.
Are we going to, like, parody the film on stage?
No, that's an awful film.
That's the worst idea I've ever heard in my entire life.
I like that movie.
Awful film.
I liked it.
It's awful.
Okay, well, I didn't.
All right, I gotta call somebody. I have to call somebody.
It's not even like an opinion. It's a fact that it's awful. That's how bad it is.
I don't know how much I agree with you.
It is.
I think
hated the movie.
Please, ride cymbal hi-hat.
Okay.
If you need a crash cymbal, you can grab one off the...
Okay. No, this will be absolutely perfect.
Yeah.
Sorry, we're filming for a documentary that we're doing on the concert.
Oh, concert documentary.
Yeah. Which part of this can I set on fire?
What? What?
Which part can I set on fire?
Well, none of it. You can't set my drum set on fire.
I'm going to show you something. I'm going to show you the Heartache wall of sound, right? Two Fender 25R frontmans. We've got this 200-watt Yorkville on loan from the Stones. This is a homemade crate amp that we made out of some speakers I found in an old abandoned theater. And this thing was from the first band that Josh and I were in together, a little band called Wishing Well.
The beauty.
It's, it does the job as far as vocals go. Yeah.
I get them shows, and it's more of a give and take sort of thing. I mean, I don't really receive, and I guess neither do they. They were for two benefit shows, and I mean, they didn't get money, and I didn't get money. I mean, I guess I bring them cookies.
No, I feel like as a band, we did a lot of good stuff. I mean, we didn't only like play shows and stuff. We used to do, you know, charity benefits. We did a Christmas album. We did a collaboration with Bill Lansky, local rapper. I guess he's from Hartford, Connecticut, but he did a few appearances with us. We went on tour, and we liked him, and we did a collaboration. We covered his song, Love Song. Babe, you got it going on. And he did Who's My Tech. And I mean, I won't lie, working with Bill Lansky is easily one of the biggest nightmares I've ever had to do in my entire life.
I enjoyed it in that it was a completely different kind of different thing that we usually do, but Bill was going through a pretty bad shampoo problem. He would inject like pert shampoo pretty much directly into his vein. And that's how he got his kicks. But it really did. It made the recording process really tough. Really, really tough. Like, he'd show up, 3 hours late, and we never got anything done. And it was like a two-song EP. And it took like 3 months.
I'm doing a documentary on A Heartache Remembered.
Yeah.
Yeah, can I get you to comment on your collaboration, Heartache in the Hood, with Heartache Remembered?
Yeah. Wait, who is this?
I'm trying to...
No. Okay, can you hold on? All right, what? Okay, who is this? We really worked hard. Can you hold on a sec? Keep it down. All right. We really thought that this was one of our best records. Who is this again?
I just got, stressed out. Just the, not only the normal rigors of life, but just... Band life can be very stressful at times. I would come sit out here on this porch, in this exact chair, actually, same chair, and just let the wind breeze through my hair, take a couple deep breaths and listen to the noises of this wonderful neighborhood.
Mike's motorcycle accident.
Yes.
And I remember visiting him in the hospital. And he started singing Literary Woman, in his full body cast. He couldn't sing well because he was more like wailing because he was in so much pain. And
plus all the drugs they had to pump into him.
Oh, wow. There was so much
he couldn't enunciate.
I can't even...
It was very much just... but
then,
very, very touching
beautiful.
Moment.
I don't remember crying so much.
I had a motorcycle on me then, so I was driving that home with this chick on the back, and we were going back to my apartment to rest. And it was a dark road. My light was dim on the front of my motorcycle, and out of nowhere, this little cat ran in front of my motorcycle, and I hit the cat, and we flew off the motorcycle down a cliff, and the motorcycle blew up, and that's all I remember. The next thing I woke up, I was in a full body cast. Oh boy, that was a night.
I was at my Malibu flat. I got the call, and I think it was Kyle. Kyle was already at the hospital or something, and he was like, "You probably want to get down here. Mike's been in a pretty bad accident." And immediately, my first thought was like, "This is the end of Heartache." Kyle didn't really. Nobody had all the details. The doctors didn't really know if he was stable or not or whatever. But anyway, I rushed down there obviously, and Josh and Kyle were already there. I guess I was just the last one that got the call, and Mike was just. Like the cliche, like something you see in like a comedy movie, Mike was just, just like, I could barely see his eyes. And it was heartbreaking. No pun intended. It was heartbreaking to see him like that. And we were right in the middle of moving to deeper levels, last track on Origami Guitar. And it was just, everything shut down when Mike when Mike got in the accident. And I mean, we kind of, I didn't really see anybody. We all met up to see Mike, but really recording just, that's part of why I guess moving to Deeper Levels took so long is, you know, halfway through Mike was just out of it, just gone, like completely. But eventually they said, hey, he's gonna be fine, and he got out probably, I don't know, 3-4 months later, something like that. And he was still kind of like, he was like, he was fragile, I guess you could say. But we got back into the recording, and it was a little weird because we hadn't played together in a while, and Mike's fingers kind of had to, you know, come back out of their cocoon. But, you know, it went well. We jammed on some older stuff, and everything was okay again. But, you know, for a while there, it was kind of on the edge of a knife as far as whether or not Heartache could come back from such an almost loss, you know, that kind of thing.
I went up right by his bedside. I held his cast. And I said, Mike, can you hear me? Are you okay? And I just heard, vroom. So I don't even, that might not even have been him. I don't know.
No, but I think that definitely when Michael came in, when he started writing lyrics, was really like,
yeah,
you know, really, really revolutionary. When it, like when he came in with Fried, and also when he came in with what else did he write? You know,
he wrote a lot of songs that never really came to fruition, but many of them
they existed. Like the fact that he was writing was good. We didn't really use any of them.
I think we all knew that. We're probably going to use less than 10% of what he writes.
But the 10% is okay.
Yeah. In fact, I still have folders of just music he's written. He's, when it comes to lyrics, he's just a visionary. He's a, what's that word?
I don't, he's
someone that's just really good at music.
He's a savant.
Savant.
He's a prodigy. Lyrical. He is what we needed.
Yeah. And, he gave us some of our biggest hits, and it wasn't so much that the lyrics made it good, but the lyrics inspired us to write good music.
Yeah.
And the inclusion of Michael Lombardo into our band was really the keystone that held us.
Yeah.
In place, and it was the point from which we made our jump into the music scene.
As far as tour life goes, normally they all have to stay in one room. They make me sleep on the floor most of the time. They fight a whole lot, normally between Mitch and Kyle. Mitch has a whole thing that he wants Heartache to have, I guess, like a certain style, and you know, Mitch wants to wear bandanas on his leg, tied on his leg, and Kyle thinks it's stupid. And I mean, we almost didn't have a show because Kyle said that if Mitch didn't take off the stupid bandana, that he wouldn't perform. So we almost had to find a replacement for Kyle, and then Kyle cried about it. He got upset, and they forgave each other, but normally it ends with Kyle crying and Mitch crying, and Mike sits there a lot.
I'd go as far as to say we're two peas in a pod, but occasionally...
I would not say
well,
that.
Well, you didn't let me finish. That's... Occasionally one of the peas in the pod is rotten and can't stand the other pea, so...
Yeah, I was gonna say, I don't like you that much.
Okay, personal influences. Oh... Tchaikovsky, pretty big influence, just because he's loud and dissonant, and I feel like I can be that way. Peter, from Peter, Paul, and Mary. Johnny Marr, from the Smiths.
Who am I inspired by? Top five favorite drummers of all time. Animal from the Muppets. That's about it. That's top one.
Well, I wouldn't say that I have very many influences, musically, because I believe that too many influences would disturb my rock genius. But I'm a natural guy, so I'd say the earth, the wind, and the fire are my main influences, because I just kind of go with the flow all the time. But with that, I'd say that the band has influenced me a little too, the soul and their funk.
Very big black man playing bass on the street, just playing an electric bass, booming away, and I was like, what is that noise? I like the noise of the being able to shake the entire street, everyone being able to hear it. It just had the raw power. So I went up to him and I said, can you teach me how to play this instrument, this wonderful human emotion that comes out? Show me how to capture that. And so my parents shipped me away to his house. He lived in the Louisiana Bayou for 6 months, and he taught me the ins and out of playing the bass, blues, jazz, everything pretty much. Oh. It's my agent. I'm going to have to take this call.
The music is very complicated, but my parts aren't, so they asked me to play some organ. I was like, you know, I don't really play rock organ per se, but it's something I was going to give a try. And the more I did research on rock organ, I realized you really don't actually have to know how to play. As long as you play from this side of the keyboard up and play really loud, that's basically every song ever written.
When Chris joined the band, I just was like, what the fuck?
We needed a new direction. We didn't really know what we were doing. And Chris had just gotten back from India or something, I don't even know where, but he really just had this kind of groove that he just kind of plunking around like as a joke, and then we're like, yeah, that's actually pretty cool. And we started working with it, and we probably spent a good 3 months just playing D minor. I don't know what we were. I mean, it was cool at the time, but it was one chord for like 3 months. I don't even know.
I'm actually really glad to be back in the U.S. I studied abroad, brought my keyboard over, and learned some riffs from some monks in the Middle East. And I don't know, I feel like it really made an impact on my overall musicianship. And, you know, when I started playing with Heartache, I was like, hey, let's try it a little funky, you know. And they dug it. They, you know, really got into it. And it was kind of unexpected. It was kind of, you know, like a little secret passion, this Indian groove, if you will. But I don't know. I think it put Heartache in a good direction. I mean, it really kind of, you know, knocked them back on track.
Well, I just feel like I really branched out as far as my vocal, you know, style goes. I mean, it wasn't really words, but I feel like I got to a whole new, like those monks are always talking about new planes of existence or whatever. I felt like my vocal cords kind of did that.
He's certainly a virtuoso of the keyboard, but I believe, and this is just my personal belief, so a lot of people don't think this, that he's kind of a waste of time, he likes to just sit around and do nothing. And then when he does do something, it's not productive, it's just a big long, like for example, we did this, Chris had gone to India, that's all he ever talked about, he never shut up about it. And Mitch, Chris, and Michael on drums, did this really long Indian style music jam. I'm not trying to, you know, stereotype, it was just Indian style. And it was just, after sitting through it for about a minute, I couldn't stand it anymore, and I just walked right out of the practice session, so.
It was, I mean, you know, it was a bit of a detour. A little.
I've never felt such a wonderful feeling. I think that was partially because their sound quality was so much better. They have the budget now to make these songs that really have a you know, a richer sound and a fuller sound. The drums are less grainy. The guitars are clearer. There's a warm, wet sound to it. Kind of like flogging a dog. I can't really explain, but it's really gone uphill. And Quantum Fishes is, I'm projecting to be number one album of all time. Not a doubt in my mind. I'm really looking forward to Quantum Fishes, because I'm hoping that it will bring Ronald Reagan back to life.
I feel like, you know, as a group ourselves, we've really gotten a lot farther than we, like, we started out really low, and we've really risen higher. You know?
Stand up and walk out on me. Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song. I will try not to sing out of key. Yeah. Oh, baby, how do you lie? All I need is my body. I say I'm gonna get high. Tell no insane no more.
Okay, yeah, here's a better list. Top five favorite scientists of all time. Number one, Bill Nye. Number two, Einstein. Number three, Doc Ock. Number four, Isaac Newton. Number five, Bill Nye.